Okay, good morning. At this time, I'm going to call the meeting of the Subcommittee on Military and Veterans Facilities to order. I'm going to ask Representative Gentz to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Thank you. I have to, my one comment is we say the Pledge of Allegiance a lot in this building, and every time I get to say it, I find some other part of the pledge to be of interest in my brain as it's going on. And this morning it was for all. So thank you all for being here. That's part of what we represent, and proud to be part of this committee for those reasons, that we do it together. I'd also like to recognize Chairman Williams, Craig Williams, if you'd like to make a couple comments.
No, I'm good. Thank you very much. Right.
Thank you, sir. We have two pieces of legislation today, and I certainly look forward to hearing from my colleagues and having a conversation this morning, a discussion about the two pieces of literature. So to that end, we'll move directly to the subcommittee's business. Jamie, would you please call the roll?
Chairman Webster?
Here.
Chairman Solomon? Here. Representative Borowski, vote by designation. Representative Gentz? Here. Representative Monroe? Here. Chairman Williams?
Here.
Chairman Gillen? Here. Representative Kerwin?
We have a quorum. Thank you. We're gonna start the meeting this morning a little bit self-serving, it seems, but I will call up for the subcommittee's review, House Resolution 30, printers number 270, which I have introduced. House Resolution 30 directs the Joint State Government Commission to conduct a study and issue a report on Junior ROTC, so Junior Reserve Officers Training Corps programs in schools in Pennsylvania. Just a brief note, these JROTC programs are offered in some high schools across Pennsylvania, but not very many. And I think the value, the interest for all of us today is that these programs instill in students the values of citizenship, service, and personal responsibility, and I would hazard to say when some of us talk about the need to, you know, to teach civics, to understand what are the processes of citizenship in the United States of America and in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, this is just one more way that we can sort of do that organically. You learn by example in JROTC. So that's what the resolution is for, to direct the Joint State Government Commission to sort of evaluate what are the standards, how many programs do we really have, what are the issues and health of those programs, and then offer some recommendations back to this committee to consider how we might address JROTC in Pennsylvania. So on the resolution, is there any discussion?
Yeah, thank you, Chairman. I think it's worth noting that, you know, your source of commissioning in the United States Air Forces was by way of the Academy and finished your career as a colonel. I appreciate your service. Likewise, mine was in ROTC through Duke University. I did not come through the junior ROTC program, as you noted, through high school. And in my portion of Alaska where I grew up, junior ROTC in high school was rather robust. But as you and I would acknowledge, that was some time ago. and I think that this is a very smart approach. I'm not aware, truly not aware, of any JROTC programs in the high schools in my district. And they may exist, but they must be very small because I don't see them. And I would also think that if they existed, they would reach out to you know, one of the two colonels that are sitting in office in their area to talk to those cadets in the JROTC program. I think that it must come back. And my daughter just went this week to a program sponsored by our local congresswoman to talk about how she might apply to the service academies. Those programs are pretty well established and noticed to the public. The ROTC programs and their four-year scholarships are adequately noticed to the public, but I don't think kids in high school, by and large, understand that there's a program right in front of them that, as you noted, will teach them about service, teach them about discipline, structure, and all of the things that draw young people to the military in the first place already exist in high school. So again, I think this is a very smart approach. I'd like to know what's happened over the last 30 or 40 years to dissuade young people from being in junior ROTC, and I encourage its approval. Thank you.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. Are there any other discussions? Yeah, Rep. Genst.
I'd just like to say that my son Alex, 25 years ago, I really wanted to go into a JROTC program, and we had to go as far away as Front Royal, Virginia. He spent his senior year down there, got his pilot's license at the same time, and just absolutely loved it, and went from there into the U.S. Army. And I would have loved to have had it happen somewhere within my district, but it wasn't to be. And I think that we should really put a push out there, you know, to our public high schools, you know, to have a program like this. And I think it would be really important for our kids, because I'm really adamant about, I really believe that our children should have like 2 years of service in our country. You know, it teaches them so much and gets them so involved.
Thank you. Are there any other? Yes, Representative Kerwin.
Thank you, Chairman. And I would just echo the sentiments that were already expressed about JROTC. As somebody that did senior ROTC in college and then commissioned into the military, I can attest to the value that I learned through ROTC. There was a school in a portion of the district that I no longer represent prior to after redistricting that did have ROTC, JROTC, and I was able to see the positive impacts that that program had on kids. And I think that's something that we can look at, something that we can see if there's a way to expand that positive impact all throughout our state. And the things that the kids learn in JROTC can be carried forward throughout the rest of their lives. So I'm happy to be in support of this. Thank you.
I really appreciate that comment, because I do think whether that individual serves in the military or not, they carry those characteristics forward in some way. Are there other comments that Representative Gillen, Chairman Gillen?
Mr. Chairman, we have actually several very robust JROTC programs in our area with some larger high schools involved. And the reason I mention that is because they really showcase the best in the young people in those high schools. You have leadership, citizenship, and fitness, first aid, they're all on display. But I see them actively serving. We have an annual dinner dance for veterans through the county of Berks, and it's held at Wilson High School. And the JROTC, not only front and center, they're running substantial portions of the program. We have a military history museum in the area, and they've served as color guard. They're active in parades. They're augmenting all of the good things that are going on in the veterans community. And so however we can amplify, and grow that through this bill, I'm excited to learn what this study is going to reveal. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
We'll acknowledge Chairman Williams one more time.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I'm glad that everybody's jumping on board your resolution. There's a lot of enthusiasm for this. Since I made my comments, staff handed me a document that confirmed that there are no JROTC units in my district. And in fact, statewide, there are 30 units out of 501 high schools. So there's very definitely a need out there. Thank you again.
All right. Thank you. With no further discussion, is there a motion to return House Resolution 30, introduced by yours truly, Representative Webster, to the Veterans Affairs and Emergency Preparedness Committee?
So moved.
Motion by Representative Kerwin, seconded by Representative Genst. Thank you. Therefore, are there any, right, we're going to vote, right? Are there any negative votes? Seeing none, House Resolution 30, right, carries, and the subcommittee will notify the House Veterans Affairs and Emergency Preparedness Committee of the same. So now we're going to bring up Senate Bill 162, printer's number 43, introduced by Senator Hutchinson for the subcommittee's review. And Senator Hutchinson, would you like to make some comments? Please proceed when you're ready, sir.
Thank you very much, and appreciate your accommodation and consideration of this bill. Back in 2014, I was happy to work with the National Guard to help them have a special incentives for, at the time, it was primarily medical officers that they were having a hard time recruiting and retaining. And so we put a bill in place to help them with that. Has been very successful, but we wanted to retool that, add a couple of other specialties that now these, now it's 9 years, I guess, later, that they have some other specialties that aren't some other medical specialties, but also some, my understanding is we have an amendment to do some additional categories of where they're having particularly hard time of recruiting and retaining guardsmen and guards ladies. So we are happy to put forward this bill. It is, it instead of saying that the incentives are based on what your profession is, it would say that the incentives are based on your educational attainment and your years of service. So that sort of clears up exactly how the money would go out, and obviously the higher your educational attainment, the longer years of service, the higher your extra monthly stipend would be. So I think this is a again, and the Guard agrees that this has been a successful program. We're making it better. We're targeting some additional specialties, and hopefully we can get this across the finish line so that we can have a full-strength National Guard. So if you have any questions, happy to do that.
Are there any questions for Senator Hutchinson while he's at the microphone? Chairman Williams?
Senator, thank you for being here. I eventually became a JAG in the Marine Corps by way of a program in the Marine Corps called Excess Leave, which allowed me to go to law school full-time, but I had to foot the bill. I was fortunate in that I remained on active duty the whole time that I was in law school and therefore could afford it. What we saw on the active duty component was, especially amongst the, let's just, for lack of a better way to describe them, call them the professional services like the chaplain corps, the legal corps, and medical corps, that people who were directly assessing into the military from professional schools brought with them tremendous debt. And it was a disincentive for those junior officers staying on active duty beyond one tour because they had to get out and cover that debt. I assume that's a problem for the National Guard as well, since their recruitment program is not even as vibrant as it is on the active duty side. In other words, they've got to only solicit volunteers from the Commonwealth. Is there any thought, maybe not in this bill, but any thought generally in the Senate about the state providing incentives with regard to loan reimbursement?
I don't know that we've ever thought about doing it to the loan reimbursement, but this is a monthly stipend that could be used for payments. I don't. You mentioned chaplains and JAG. Those are the two of the specialties that amendment would add to this bill that is supported by myself as well as by the Adjutant General's office. something they want and need. But as far as going directly to loan repayment, I think that hasn't been thought of at this point.
Yeah, and the only reason I bring it up is, again, if you're talking about bringing the best from those professions into the military and into service in the Pennsylvania National Guard, that is a preeminent concern of theirs, is medical school loans and law school loans, and how they're going to bridge that gap. Now, of course, in the National Guard, that perhaps is a lesser issue because this is their second job, right? So they're going to have a primary occupation out in the world. But again, this is something we've been wrestling with for, you know, like the chairman and his JROTC bill for 20 plus years, is how do you keep the best and brightest in the service, right, when they're fighting such a mountain of debt? I mean, law school these days is more than undergraduate, so that's approaching $75,000 to $80,000 a year. So anyway, just put that on your plate.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Senator, any other comments before we allow you to?
No, I don't, but again, I appreciate you considering this, and to the extent that we can make this the best possible piece of legislation, we just wanted to get the idea across the finish line this time. So thank you for your help.
You bet. I do want to recognize that prior to this program being launched originally, you know, the fill rate on some of these positions was as low as 32%. And so we can see that the program's effective over time, that we're now at somewhere around 65% to 75%.
It has been very, very successful. Yeah. We want to make it even more so. So
I appreciate that very much. I know that Rep. Kerwin would like to make a couple comments.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I want to thank Senator Hutchinson, the prime sponsor of the bill. This is a vital bill, which is going to make sure high-quality professionals not only join the National Guard, but also stay in the National Guard. I will be offering an amendment for recommendation to the full committee, Amendment 01908. This amendment would change the subchapter heading from healthcare to reflect the branches that we previously talked about to specialty branch officer incentive program, and it's to encompass all of those branches, the legal, the medical, and the chaplain corps. It would authorize chaplains from the U.S. Chaplain Corps to participate in the program if they meet certain prerequisites, and also authorize JAG officers, attorneys, to participate as well. On a personal note, as a member of the National Guard, somebody that's been in the Pennsylvania National Guard for 12 years now, this is going to be a vital tool to make sure people stay in the National Guard. I've seen personally soldiers get out of the Army National Guard to go on to the medical, to the legal career fields, and not stay in the National Guard because there's no incentive to keep them there. They realize that they're going to go and make more money in the civilian sector, and they don't need the National Guard as part of their life. By adding this incentive, that's going to make them think twice. And these are the very type of people that we want to keep in Pennsylvania's National Guard, because they're going to make the National Guard more effective for the state and also for the nation as a whole. So I'd ask that we recommend Amendment 01908 to the full committee for consideration. And again, I thank the prime sponsor of the bill as well for his work on it. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
On the discussion of that recommendation to amend the bill, are there any other discussions? Mr. Chairman, would you like to address that? Okay. I will add just one thought. I'm sorry, I didn't see Chairman Gill.
Yeah, I'd like to amplify on my colleagues' comments, Representative Kerwin, Representative Craig Williams, and thank you both for your distinguished service. I'm always amazed that somebody who looks like he's 20 years old has been in the National Guard for 12 years. I may add that probably his workouts have something to do with it, because I saw him going into the exercise room recently. The stipend would barely cover, as we talked about, loans and debt, would probably barely cover the interest on a loan that was $75,000 or reaching in the six figures. And so I think that's probably a next generation thought in terms of moving forward legislatively. I want to thank my colleague. I think we served together on the Veterans Affairs Committee, if I'm not mistaken, back in the day. And I was actually having a discussion with our executive director and pulled out of my mind the 2014 bill, which we're amplifying on. I think the incentivization is critical. Recruitment, retention, always ought to be vocabulary words in all of our minds. And most of all, I want to thank a senator for actually appearing in person. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Representative Gentz.
Exactly what is the incentive that we want to offer them?
So the incentive is going to mirror what's already offered in SB 162, and I'd let the prime sponsor expound on that if he'd like to as well. I believe it's $750 a month for 36 months of service, for the first 36 months of service.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, it's actually $1,000 if you have a doctorate degree, $750 a month for a master's degree, and $500 for specialties with a bachelor degree.
Is there any other discussion on the recommended amendment, Rep. Kerwin?
Well, yeah. And on a lighter note, I'd just like to clarify that although I'm an attorney in the civilian trade, I am an infantry officer in the National Guard, so I don't stand to benefit from this point at all.
Appreciate that very much. I'm going to, just a short comment, I certainly endorse the amendment, the recommendation that we'll make to the full committee to expand the program and consider that. And I will add for later discussion, I've had the opportunity to talk to the Adjutant General and to Brigadier General Regan about this, to start talking about our cyber warriors who are in a very similar scenario where their skill levels are extraordinarily high and their pay rates in the civilian commercial world are double or triple what's going on. So while our Air National Guard at Biddle Guard Base has a cyber mission, we have a very real recruiting and retention problem around that. And I think we should consider that at a later time as well. So thank you. Having that recommendation, are there any negative votes on Senate Bill? I'll go all the way back and get the number, 162. Okay, thank you. Seeing no negative votes, keep going. I'm off the, that's right, I'm off the script here. I do need a motion to endorse the recommendation from Chairman Williams. Second, Rep. Ron Monroe will second the motion, thank you. and then I'll ask for votes. Are there any negative votes on the motion or Senate Bill 162? Seeing none, the motion carries, and we will, I have to go back to the other page.
Nope.
Yep. We will recommend that the bill in its present form with recommendations for amendments is returned to the full committee. And that concludes our business for today. Are there any other comments or business that we should consider before the committee, before we adjourn? Seeing none, this meeting is adjourned. Thank you.